Hello, I made a reel in quantum computing and it didn't do too bad. 8,000 views, that's better than the other reels I've been doing. Anyway, in that reel, I said this.
Here's an extreme oversimplification of how quantum computing works. Current computers can only do one process at a time, one, then zero, while quantum computers can do multiple processes simultaneously.
Now that's not technically correct. QCs use something called qubits, and trying one and zero at the same time isn't actually what they do. If you'd like the too long, didn't read breakdown, QCs are not just faster supercomputers. They are instead fundamentally different tools for processing and understanding data. One is not necessarily better than the other, but QCs are better at certain things than supercomputers. All of that said, I still think the metaphor of trying one and zero at the same time is a good metaphor for how they will break through cryptography. Which means I have to explain what cryptography is. What is cryptography? Okay, cryptography. The primary purpose of cryptography is to protect data from unauthorized access and ensure its confidentiality, integrity, and authenticity. Okay, we're done. There are a few types of cryptography, also known as encryption protocols. For this video, I'm going to stick with symmetric and asymmetric encryption. Let's say you want to be able to store all of your credit cards digitally, but you don't want anyone else to be able to see them. That's an area where you could use symmetric encryption. You can take your file and lock it away, like a pirate's chest. How you do this is through encryption. Once something is encrypted, the only way to open it again is through the use of a unique key, or a sledgehammer. Encrypting something changes what is known as plain text into ciphertext. The cipher and ciphertext is exactly what you think it is. Ciphers have been used for hundreds of years with a wide range of complexity to jumble up messages so they can only be decrypted through the use of a unique cipher key. Modern encryption uses incredibly long and extremely complicated math problems to create ciphers that are almost impossible to hack. So encrypting something doesn't actually lock your files inside of anything, and instead scrambles them up into something that is almost impossible to understand without a unique cipher key. Now, to be clear, with current supercomputers, there is no encryption that is technically impossible to break. Let's go back to that sledgehammer. This is called a brute force attack. Basically, someone sets up a computer, sometimes hundreds of computers, working round the clock 24/7 on breaking through that encryption. Given enough time and processing power, there is no encryption that can't be cracked this way. The reason everyone considers encryption safe is because it would take an absurdly long time to break modern encryption. We're talking hundreds to even thousands of years in some cases. In symmetric encryption, there is only one key. This is used for locking and unlocking your information. This is great for files that only need to be accessed by one person or one party. But what if you need to send information securely? This is an area where you would use asymmetric encryption. In asymmetric encryption, there are two keys. One is called the public key, and it is used for adding information to the encryption. The other one is called the private key, and it is used for unlocking all of the encryption. This is how you can make secure credit card purchases online. When you enter your information online, it is immediately encrypted for safekeeping using the public key. Then, only a secure transaction provider who has the private key can unlock the information, approve the transaction, and then re-encrypt everything. So everything is safe and there's no need to worry, right? Unfortunately, wrong. Ciphertext gets stolen all of the time. If you've ever heard of big companies like Facebook or Target being hacked, with hundreds of thousands of people's data being released, fortunately, in many cases, that information is encrypted and it's just not worth a hacker's time to try and break into it. What they do, however, is store that information away with the hope they can break into it later or sell it on the dark web to someone else who would be interested in breaking into it. Let's go back to QCs and their qubits. Quantum computers are something called qubits and they can store any value between 1 and 0. Like in this graph, I totally understand. This is one of the properties of quantum mechanics that uses waves and probability, and that's about as much as I understand it. And please don't be mad at me, quantum computer fans. I'm a moron. There are predictable ways that quantum mechanics will act. One of these is how qubits will act in something called quantum entanglement. Entanglement happens when qubits get close enough to each other to start interacting with one another. One of the things that will reliably happen is that the qubits will synchronize to find the most effective use of energy, kind of like these cool metronomes. These reliable interactions allow for the creation of algorithms that can watch the interactions of qubits and translate that data to solve certain complex problems. Okay, let's try and connect all the dots. In short, supercomputers are amazing and they can do a lot of really crazy things.
The Predator is 100% biodegradable, it's friendly to the Earth, and it can hurt you in 100 ways. It has warrior capacities, and it looks a little bit funny.
But they are very slow at solving very long, very complicated math problems. Because they have to try every option one after another, after another, after another, after another. And when the numbers are super long, it just takes forever. Well, it turns out that one of the things that QCs excel at is finding order in long, complicated sequences. And this is why QCs are seen as a threat to current encryption types. The good news is there is already new types of encryption being created to address the concerns of quantum computing. So we're great, there's no need to worry about any of this.
Jesus, you had like the whole desert to drive inland.
Unfortunately, threat actors are taking steal now, break later very seriously. They go out of their way to steal as much encrypted data as they can with the hope of breaking into it later or selling it on the dark web. And you don't have to look far for examples of this already happening. On November 30th, 2022, LastPass notified customers of a security incident on their network and notified them that this may have included copies of security vaults. Now that the hackers have that data offline, they are free to run as many brute force attacks on it as they would like. It is speculated that those stolen vaults have led to over $35 million in crypto being stolen. But crypto whales are not the only example. Currently, there are massive amounts of data being stolen and stored. The security concern is once that data starts being broken into, what information will be pulled out? And how will it be used to hurt individuals, organizations, businesses, or governments? So what can you do? The best option is to be proactive about cybersecurity. A lot of what makes the difference between someone being an easy target and being secure is small but proactive steps. As an example, in an interview with one of the victims of the crypto theft, he noted, "Because I set up my LastPass account so early, I'm pretty sure it had whatever weak settings or iterations it originally had. And I'd set up a brand new wallet with new keys. I had that ready to go 2 months ago, but I've been procrastinating moving things to a new wallet." 2 months doesn't seem that long in our daily lives, but in internet time, that's a small eternity. But that's why being proactive about updates, patches, and changing passwords is so critical. You're going to make yourself far more difficult to hack, which means you're far less likely to be a target, which means you're far less likely to have things stolen. Then, as technology moves forward, you can update your data to new encryption forms that will continue to keep your data safe. But the importance of starting to take a proactive approach now cannot be overstated.
The quantum chip considers every possible solution all at the same time.
And you're collapsing to this one answer that will actually be the answer you're after.
Eric's proved that quantum computing has the potential to smash the codes that protect the internet.
Oh, video's over. I probably got all that quantum computing stuff wrong, to be honest.
Closing time. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay.